Hi there, Lindsay here, the Frugal Crafter. Today we're going to look at many ways you can use background stamps creatively. This video is brought to you by TopFlightStamps.com. That's where I got the stamps I'm using today from, and I will have them all linked down below. Top Flight Stamps travels the globe and finds the coolest stamps all over the world and brings them back to us here in the United States. These stamps are primarily from Darkroom Door. We're going to start off on this first project and do a resist. So I'm just removing the protective layer that comes on the back of a brand new stamp, and then I'm putting it on my stamp block. This is a curved stamp mount called a Mega Mount, and I really love it for these large background stamps because it helps me get a really good impression, because you don't get that spot in the middle of the stamp that doesn't want to stamp when you use one of these curved blocks. Another way I sometimes ink up these stamps is by laying them on my table and then putting my paper on top of the stamp. I dusted off my cardstock with a baby powder bag. It's just a little bag I sewed up with some baby powder in it to take any static off the paper and whisk away any moisture, and then I just stamped it with clear VersaFine and then coated it with some clear embossing powder. You can also use white embossing powder, but I think clear is just a little glossier and shinier and resists the ink a little bit better. After tapping the excess off into the embossing powder container, I heated it up with my heat tool, and now I've got a shiny image here. And these are some vintage buttons, in case you couldn't tell from the packaging there. So now I'm going to tape this down to my table, because this is where the fun technique comes in. This is a stenciled resist. So I'm going to use this Starburst stencil. It's a scrapbooking stencil, so it's 12 by 12, but you could use a smaller one, obviously, if you wanted to. And I taped that down as well, so I don't have to worry about it moving when I'm inking, because there's a lot of little windows here in the stencil that I want to ink up. You can use any pattern that you like for this. Just make sure the windows are big enough that you can get a good patch of ink. There are some smaller windows here, but I can always ink the ray next to it if I feel like I need to. So I went around this Starburst design in kind of rainbow order here. And after I had inked up all the pieces, I removed the stencil. Now the negative and positive spaces don't match up exactly, so I just had to remove the stencil. And then I'm going to use post-it notes to block off the inked area and then ink in between. And I'm just going to try to fill in the missing spots in my spectrum as close as I can. I think there was something like 22 different rays here, so I needed to come up with like about 22 different colors that were a little bit different from one another. Or if I found that I had one like little ray that was a little too skinny, I might combine it with a ray next door so that I would have a larger area. I just love when I see the design revealed when I do a resist like this. And you could, of course, just do this freehand with ink over your resisted design. You don't have to use a stencil, but I think it's just a fun way to get a little more use out of those stencils, especially if you have the big scrapbooking ones, or maybe you have some wall stencils left over from a home decor project. You could totally use that for this. Then after you have it all inked, take a clean tissue or a soft cloth and just wipe off any residue that might be on top of your embossing. And there you can see you have that really fun rainbow image. So to make this a little bit more stable to work with, what I did was I just used my adhesive runner to mat this on a piece of thick black cardstock. That's that 110-pound stuff you can get at like Michael's or Joann's. They make heavyweight stuff in your neutrals, which is really nice for your card bases and just making it feel a little bit more, luxurious. And then I die cut a couple different hearts, and I was just trying to figure out what design I liked better. I had a primitive and I had a standard heart, and I decided that I liked the standard heart better. I also took another look at my inking and realized I wanted some more of this nice bright cherry red color in there, so I'm just using my finger tool to add some of that to my design. I have lots of white buttons, and I thought it would be really cute to adhere some white buttons to a die cut and then use that for my main embellishment. So what I did was I took my classic foam squares that fans of the channel have been seeing for like 10 years and mounted that to my card, but we'll be changing that a little bit in a few minutes. Then I just filled in the heart with some wet glue. I used my Beacon 3-in-1 because that's super strong. And then I just used different size buttons to try and fill the heart as best as I could. Now, after I got that done, I was kind of a little disappointed that it didn't stand out as much as I thought it would. So I had to think on that a little bit. I was a little I just was a little concerned that there wasn't enough contrast between the physical button heart and the inked button background. So what I did was I ended up pulling that heart off the background. Because of the embossed images and it hadn't been stuck down too long, I could remove it. So that was great. And then I just cut a slightly bigger heart with black cardstock and I mounted that down so it would stand up a little bit more or stand out a little bit more. At this point, I'm still not 100% in love with an idea, but sometimes you just gotta let something sit for a bit and then come back to it. Now, this stamp here isn't technically a background stamp. However, it's a sentiment stamp that comes in a strip. Now, I think they intend you to cut those apart and have those all individual sentiments, but I think it's way more useful to leave it all together because that way you can use it as one background or border, or you can just cut out the sentiments that you need, which is what I did here. And I'll show you another idea for these types of stamps at the end of the video, so make sure you stick around for that. After I trimmed out the large script Taffy Birthday, and I love script stamps because I don't like my own handwriting very much, but I love that look of handwriting on cards, so anything with a script like that, I'm totally all over. I thought that would look really cute. And then I thought I would dress it up a little bit and bring back a little more rainbow by using some eyelets that I had in my stash from back in the day, bringing out all those old scrapbooking goodies, the big stencils, the eyelets, all those fun things. And then I just put a couple whimsical eyelets on the top and bottom. I just went with kind of primary and tertiary colors in rainbow order just to really amp up the fun in this card. The eyelets give it kind of a fun polka dot look, and I really think it reflects all the round buttons that we have on the card. I used foam squares to adhere this to make it stand out a little bit, and then I still felt like the card needed something, so I added some glue and all the nooks and crannies on the button element, and then I spritzed on some glitter with a Tim Holtz glitter spritzer. Honestly, shaking on clear glitter works just as well. And there you can see the finished card. I'm really happy with the way it turned out. For this next project, we are going to get mixed media messy. And even if you're a clean and simple stamper, I would highly recommend trying out a few of these techniques on your next card because they're so fun. Again, we're going to start off with a background stamp, this time of butterflies, and we're going to ink it up with some clear Versamark ink. And remember, that's a sticky ink we use for embossing, but I'm going to show you something else you can do with it. You want to make sure when you stamp this, you get really good contact with your stamp. So I'm using my curved mount again, and I'm stamping on like a pad of newsprint. You could use a magazine, anything to give it a little bit of cushion underneath, just to make sure you get that really good impression, because you might not be able to tell if it's stamped well until you add the next ingredient, which is mica powder. I'm using the new Arteza set of 60 mica powders. I'm using a blue, a green, and a purple. I think I used a little bit of pink too. I want to keep with those kind of cooler colors that were going to work well together. And then you simply use a soft, fluffy brush to swirl around on the cardstock to get the mica to stick to all of that clear ink. It works really, really well. You just want to make sure you get every area covered, and then you can just kind of wipe it off with a tissue, wipe off the excess. Then you want to spray that with some hairspray. I like to use Aquanet because it's, you know, non-toxic for the most part. You know, it's hairspray and it smells like high school. So it's just takes you in a little nostalgic walk down memory lane every time you use it, which is a lot of fun. And then I'm just giving this a blast with my heat tool to dry it. And there you can see the beautiful pearlescent look that you get. I wanted to give this an artsy look, so I'm going to tear the edges of my cardstock. I probably should have left it a little bit larger because it is easier to tear cardstock when you have a little more room to go by, but this worked fine. And I just tore it to the edges of the stamp, so it was really easy. Now here what I'm doing is using a little powdered gum arabic. That's going to turn this mica powder into a mica watercolor. And then I'm going to add a little bit of water to that and stir it up. I'm just using that same brush I used for my mica powders. Just make sure your brush is dry when you use it with the dry mica powder, or make sure your brush dries out completely before you use it again with those dry powders, so you don't end up wasting a bunch of it. Now I'm just flicking on some of that pink because I thought it looks good, and I'm also going to hit the deckled edge of this panel with that pink watercolor that we made, and then again we're going to dry it. This technique looks really fantastic on any darker colored cardstock, but you can use this on white too and see what effects you like better. It will shimmer more on the black though, I'll tell you that. So now we're going to go on to our focal point of the card, and this time I'm going to use a stamp that I've had in my stash for quite a while from Paper Artsy. You can also find that at topflightstamps.com. I'm going to use a variety of watercolor markers just to color this stamp. I have it on a regular old clear stamp block this time. And you can mix and match any of your water-based markers, so don't feel like you have to have a full set of anything. You can even use the kids' Crayola markers for this technique. And I love techniques that you can use with whatever you have. Then after you've colored the image, you want to breathe on it with your breath and then stamp it right down. And that's going to re-moisten the ink enough so you get a good impression. Now, another thing you can do is actually spritz that stamp and stamp it again. Just spritz it with clean water and you will get a second generation stamp. And sometimes that's prettier than the first one you did. So it's fun. You can get a couple images and then you can take the one you like best. On that first one, though, I liked how crisp and defined it was, so I just used a wet brush to spread around some of the watercolor, or the watercolor marker, rather, just to make it fill in the wings a little bit. And now we're going to add some more fun techniques with the mica powder. I'm just using the leftover powder that was on the throwaway seal from the mica powder, and I mixed it with gum arabic, but you could use any sort of, like, glue or Mod Podge that you have, anything like that. It doesn't have to be gum arabic. It's just basically something to seal it, lock it down to the paper. So after doing my deco with that gold color, added a little more water, and I decided to bring that in onto the background and just kind of thin it out a little bit so that I had a light yellow shimmery background. Then I remembered that I had this pigment powder, these infusions, and I thought that would be so pretty into that wet light yellow color because it would really show up. So that's what I'm adding here. And you know, to really make those infusions really pop, you want to spray on some more water. So I'm kind of using this second generation paper as a scrap, and I'm just misting over that so that I can hit the infusions without hitting the dragonfly too much. And I'm just really pleased with how funky and bright and colorful this is. Now I want to do a little collage here, or kind of paper toile really, and what I'm going to do is just ink up the dragonfly using the same techniques we did before on another scrap of watercolor paper. And then I am trimming out just the body and the wings, and we're going to glue this on top of our focal point there. You want to make sure it's good and dry before you try to glue it, or the glue's not going to sit. And I just bent the wings with my fingers a bit to give them some dimension, and I'm adding glue only on the body, so it's only adhered by the body, so the wings can kind of have a little movement there, and then you can kind of peek underneath them and see the colors. I think it looks nice and it just gives you a little extra dimension. And then I'm going over the wings with a clear glitter Wink of Stella pen, or any clear glitter pen thing that you have will work just fine for that. Now, here's a tip. Whenever I'm stamping with something with words, I'll draw an arrow on the back of the stamp. So when I'm looking down through my mount, I know what side is up. And that's great to do with any sort of directional stamp that you might have. Now, this is another one of those sentiment stamps that you could cut apart if you wanted to, but I thought it would be really fun to use this as a background. So what I'm doing is just inking it up with black ink, and I'm stamping it repeatedly on the background. Now, we didn't want to line these all up. I wanted the text to be a little randomized, so that's why I staggered them, kind of like if you were laying a floor in your house. You wouldn't want all the wood to have seams all lined up. You'd want them to be staggered a little bit to look more natural. Same idea when you're stamping. And then I'm just using my ink brush and some Prism ink. It's a nice reactive ink, so I can flick water on it and get some cool water spots just to give it a little color around the edges, because you're not going to see the middle. That's going to be covered up with our papers. Now I'm using my Crocodile hole punch to set some silver eyelets in the corners, because eyelets are so fun. I don't think I'll ever get sick of them. I'll be real sad when I run out of them if they don't make them anymore, because I really like them. And then I'm using some larger silver sewing eyelets on the corners of the main panel. And I am going to take some purple metallic thread. This is, I think, meant for quilters, but I love to use it in my card making. And I kind of wove it between the eyelets on my background and on my focal point and just tied it in the back. I had put down some adhesive on the back thinking that would help me trap the threads, but it really wasn't necessary, so it just kind of was hindersome when I was working on it, but it was fine. And then I just adhered that panel onto my card base where we did our stamping. I cut out a couple of the sentiments from the that stamp we stamped the background on. I just stamped it again on a scrap of white and added that to the front of the card, and I really liked the way that looked. Now, I made a little mistake. Guys, public service announcement, cover your ink pad. I had gotten a big black smear on the inside of my card because I left a black ink pad open and I dropped my card on it. So that's why I stamped that black in there to cover it up. And then I redid that technique again because I just love it. And I stamped that on the inside of the card. This is the same marker technique. Then I sprayed my stamp again so I didn't waste that ink and stamped the second generation lighter image on the envelope. So now I have an envelope to match. So lots of fun techniques there. So much fun. I hope you try them because the marker one's not even that messy. Now in this last one, I'm going to share a technique, and this will work with whatever background stamps you have. And this is just layered background stamping. I started off by stamping the text the same way we did in the last card, just to create a background. Then what I'm going to do is put a post-it note down over happy anniversary to highlight that word. So that's going to keep me from stamping on top of that. Then what I'm going to do is take another background. It doesn't have to be related to it at all. This is just kind of sketchy flowers. And I'm going to stamp over that in another shade of ink. And I thought this kind of peachy coral would be nice. Now I'm going to put down another shape, just a die-cut heart, just to kind of, you know, go on with the anniversary theme. And I'm stamping my third stamp, which is just arrows, on top of that. I'm going to take that same colored ink that I used for that third stamp, and I'm going to ink up around the heart. Then I remove the heart and I put the window in its place, because when you die cut something, you have an innie and an outie. And then I use that first ink to ink the inside of the heart. Then when I remove my post-it note, you can see that I have the word happy anniversary highlighted. I think that's a really fun way to also spotlight a word if you have a word background stamp. I adhered that panel to a piece of craft cardstock, and I thought, well, that's kind of nice, but it's kind of plain, so I decided that I would just use some pearls to highlight around the heart. Feel free to stitch around the heart or use whatever embellishments you like or do a line of glitter, whatever you want to do. The thing I love about this technique is that you can use whatever background stamps you have, whatever colors of ink you like, and come up with completely new looks that you might not have thought of before. It's amazing how awesome this looks, even with stamps that might not look good together at all. I want to thank TopFlightStamps.com for sponsoring this video today. You can check them out in the links in the video description. I'll have a coupon code so you can save some money, and I'll have all the supplies linked down below too. I hope this video sparks some creativity and ideas for your next card making project, and thanks for watching. Till next time, happy crafting!